Good morning, Excellencies, ladies and gentlemen. It's always a pleasure to attend Arctic Frontiers, and I would like to say this year in particular, it has started in a very turbulent way, both globally and also nationally. And then there is a very good thing to know that the Arctic Frontiers will take place. We will meet the very engaged and enthusiastic participants and audience. And I think that is one of the good things about this year now. The Arctic today is a region that is characterized by peace, stability, and international cooperation. And I would like to underline that that is no coincidence. It's a result of hard and difficult and sustainable political choices. It's something that we have worked very hard to achieve, and it's something that we're going to work equally hard to maintain. I think it's fair to say that during the last years, we've seen an increase in the attention to the Arctic region. We've also heard views that there is some sort of a legal vacuum in the Arctic, a kind of no man's land. Some have argued that a new great game is taking place in the Arctic, and that we need new structures of Arctic governance, including a new security forum policy for the Arctic. First and foremost, it's extremely important to underline that there is no legal vacuum in the Arctic. On the contrary, an extensive national and international legal framework already applies to the Arctic. The law of the sea provides the basic architecture underpinning all ocean governance in the Arctic. It distributes jurisdiction and establishes clarity and predictability as regards rights and obligations for all states and in all ocean and sea areas. The law of the sea also provides important rights and obligations regarding freedom of navigation, marine scientific research, protection of the marine environment, delimitation, the outer limits of the continental shelf, and other uses of the Arctic seas. In addition to that, a series of treaties and legal instruments apply to the Arctic, as they do to all other parts of the world. A concrete example is the new agreement against unregulated fishing in the central Arctic Ocean. To sum it up, national law and international mechanisms are already in place to clearly clarify both ownership and sustainable management of the utilization of the resources in the Arctic. Ladies and gentlemen, regarding governance structures, the Arctic Council has been the primary arena for addressing international issues in the region for more than 20 years. And this was reconfirmed by the foreign ministers when we had our meeting in Rovaniemi in Finland last year. The Council, and firmly supported by, of course, all its member states, indigenous peoples and observer countries, has been instrumental in both setting the agenda, developing the new knowledge, but also in building trust between countries. I would argue that the Arctic Council has served all its members very well. The Council provides a platform for addressing these cross-border issues that sometimes can be difficult. It has been instrumental in developing new knowledge on climate change in the Arctic. And it has also been setting the agenda when it comes to discussing opportunities and challenges in the Arctic. The Arctic Council has also, in fact, facilitated the negotiation of three important and legally binding agreements between the eight Arctic states. These agreements on search and rescue, on marine oil pollution preparedness and response, and on scientific cooperation highlights areas where cross-border cooperation is not only a useful way forward, but the only way forward. Under the steady guidance of the Icelandic chairmanship, the Arctic Council will help to ensure the working program of the Council can deal effectively with future demands and challenges. In October last year, I was very proud to assume on behalf of Norway the chairmanship of the Barents Euro-Arctic Council. The forum has been actually a cornerstone of the regional cooperation ever since 1993. We will use our chairmanship to develop our relationship with our Nordic neighbors and with Russia. And the close involvement of local and regional actors in the Barents region will be crucial to achieving these goals. As many of you know, we have three priorities for our chairmanship: its knowledge, its health, and its people-to-people contact. And together with Governor Magdalena Andersson in Västerbotten, we will later today discuss some of these issues, and I hope that many of you can attend that event. One of the topics that we would like to pick up from the Swedish chairmanship is policies on youth, and that is also some of the points that we're going to discuss later on today. To deal with the challenges and to take advantage of the opportunities in the Arctic, Norway continues to believe in effective multilateral cooperation within the framework of international and national law and well-established governance structures. As many of you know, here in the Arctic, we see the effects of climate change most dramatically. The temperature rises more the further north you come. And one very prominent example is that last year, 3.3 degrees over average temperature at Svalbard, Norway's northernmost archipelago. That means that we have had 31 consecutive years with temperatures above the average at Svalbard. And 3.3 degrees in one year is quite a lot. Climate change has implications for ice conditions, for the sea level, and air temperature. But it's also important to underline that this is not directly linked to activities in the Arctic, but predominantly due to activities and emissions outside of the Arctic. That is why the Paris Agreement is so important. It's the main legal vehicle for cooperation on reducing greenhouse gas emissions. Norway, of course, intends to do our part, and our current target under the Paris Agreement is to reduce emissions by at least 40% by 2030 compared to 1990 level. But as you also know, we have issued a letter to the European Commission to make sure that we can ramp up these goals quite much. We will also, as the government of Norway, present a white paper to the Parliament later this fall on Arctic issues. We will outline our ambitions for a strong and innovative Arctic region. It will confirm our commitment to international cooperation, as foreign and domestic policies are very much interconnected in the North. And we need to follow very closely both the local and the global developments affecting the Arctic regions, and we need to be well-placed to meet them. Ladies and gentlemen, in closing, there is one thing that I think we need to repeat, not because people in this room doesn't know, but because a wider audience needs to be reminded. For Norway, the Arctic is not a remote place. It is not a place where people don't live. On the contrary, 10% of our population live north of the Arctic Circle. Some of our most innovative industrial areas are located here. Norwegians have lived by and off the sea for centuries. We will continue to utilize ocean resources. We will continue to strike the balance between protection and production. To ensure sustainable economic development in the Arctic based on the best available knowledge and science and based on the highest environmental standards. I wish all of you a very pleasant and fruitful stay here in the beautiful city of Tromsø, and now we have real winter weather here, and I hope all of you have prepared well. I saw that Stephen had prepared, especially this year, for the cold by having a small beard. It's not huge, but it's... But I think it's a way of preparing for the cold. So, ladies and gentlemen, enjoy the conference. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister.